In the first lecture, I started with reminding the audience what is critical behavior. Still, I have been talking about classical critical behavior, thinking about some PhD students. So it turns out that now the number of PhD students has decreased and number of already major people has increased. So maybe I will hurry up to some extent. So, but still I have not approached the problem of couperates, two-dimensional criticality, quantum criticality, and today I want really to start talking about quantum criticality, what it is and what it has been usually, what people were thinking about the quantum criticality and how one can work with it and what one can expect of it. And then next lectures possibly, or maybe I will start already today, I will show what happens in two dimensions when one works, for example, a near antiferromagnet normal metal phase transition, quantum phase transition. Then it turns out, and basically it was the activity of our activity here in Saclay, it has been started here in Saclay, that in principle the scenario, conventional scenario of quantum criticality in this situation when one has an antiferromagnet versus normal metal quantum phase transition in two dimensions, that in this situation everything can be different from what it was believed previously. So, first I remind you what I have been talking about last time. And so, classical criticality, it was the idea that in principle what one calculates, one composes functional, and this functional is in the simplest form is just Ginzburg-Landau expansion, and this is A delta modulus square plus B fourth plus C and here gradient modulus squared. And then if one writes this expansion, then one inserts into this, so considers all possible configurations of this space, of this functional, and just calculates the partition function or any averages using this free energy expansion, so functional of free energy, just summing over all configurations. And why the Ginzburg-Landau expansion fails near the transition? The reason is there are strong fluctuations, so one cannot take just minimum of this functional. Taking just minimum of this free energy would mean inserting this minimum into this functional, into this formula, and calculating the contribution of the minima. But if one considers also fluctuations, which means that one takes fluctuations near the minimum of this functional, then the contributions of these fluctuations are actually diverging near the phase transition. So, and I tried to say how in principle one can see these divergences formally, and formal divergences are expressed by an effective interaction, this effective quartic term, and this effective interaction is something like dk, and here C k squared plus A, n squared. And A goes to zero. So A goes to zero when so temperature tends to the critical temperature from above. And then if it goes to zero, if it becomes zero, we see that this correction to the effective interaction diverges for d smaller or equal to 4. And then one should think what to do, and this thinking has led people to scaling idea, to ideas to renormalization group, and these divergences after after being summing up properly give some exponents. So these are scaling exponents which can be calculated and not rigorously mathematically maybe, but at least one already has a good knowledge about conventional probability. Now, very important question is, what is the dimensionality? How one can determine the dimension of the system? So usually one assumes that if it is chain, it is one dimension. If it is ideal film, ideally thin film, it is two dimensions. But actually everything depends not on the number of atoms in transversal directions, but on the geometry. Because if one takes a very thick but long sample, then close to the transition, one can find such a region near the transition when the system is effectively one-dimensional anyway. How to understand that? So this this formula should be replaced by sum over transversal momenta and integral over integral over parallel momenta, and one writes here C k plus k parallel plus a squared. And looking at this formula, one sees the following, that when a goes to zero, then k parallel, so the perpendicular are equal to plus to zero, then plus minus 2p divided by L perpendicular, then 2p 2 divided by L perpendicular, or all harmonics. So if A is very small, then the main contribution comes from K perpendicular to zero. So then this means that when A goes to zero, then this sum evolves into a simple integral dk parallel, and here it is a vector. Vector in arbitrary dimension. In this picture, it is somehow just scalar, but it is anyway ck parallel squared plus a squared. So k parallel, and one writes here So this means that close to the transition, the system loses the dimension if it is restricted somehow in one direction. Then this means that one comes to a reduced dimension. So the question dimension in this quantum, in this criticality, means just geometry. So any sample can be made effectively, for example, one-dimensional. Just take some tube, and this is one-dimensional, close to the transition. Just because the transversal quantization, only zero transversal harmonics should be taken into account. That's the point. So why I say it now? Just because it will be clear when we will talk about quantum dimension, quantum criticality. Then the same effect exists when one speaks of crossover from quantum to classical behavior. So here it is crossover. It is crossover from, for example, three-dimensional, if it is just a tube, from three-dimensional behavior to one-dimensional behavior. If this k perpendicular is still smaller than a, then one has just three-dimensional. If it is larger, so this means that if 1 over L perpendicular is C squared is larger than A, this is 1D. If this is C divided, C L perpendicular squared is smaller than, okay, in principle it is much larger or much smaller, and then it is 3D. So this is crossover of dimensions. Okay, at this point I want to stop on classical criticality. So of course it is well-developed field of research, but so much developed that already each next step is very difficult. But general behavior on classical criticality is somehow is well accepted now. And, now we move to quantum criticality. So we understand that in order that the phase transition may happen when changing the temperature, but it may happen also when changing some parameter, when tuning some parameter. The most famous, mostly discussed example is this. For example, this quantum criticality phase transition between antiferromagnet normal metal or phase transition, quantum phase transition between ferromagnet normal metal. And in many cases, and the best cases of these transitions are cuprates or heavy fermions and so on. And there one has quantum criticality. But of course, this quantum criticality, although this word was not used in that time, such transitions are known and have been discussed 30 years ago. And basically what people were thinking about quantum criticality, it was somehow more simple, so the knowledge had been accumulated from more simple systems. So these cuprates or heavy fermions are already quite complicated. Therefore, just to understand, to show you, to say what is the conventional thinking of quantum criticality, I will consider maybe a simpler model, but at the same time experimentally very realistic model, and many experiments are being done in test laboratories. Although they are more, so they are older than this cuprate business or heavy fermion business. So, therefore, we come to quantum criticality, quantum critical point. So, and just to be specific, to start with, I propose a model of a network of Josephson junctions or granular superconductors, which is really considerably simpler than cuprates and so on. So therefore, I will talk a little bit about Josephson Junction, so Josephson Junctions. And as usual for theoreticians, or maybe it is already old-fashioned for theoreticians to start talking about something, one writes a Hamiltonian. Not just making proposals or whatever, but Hamiltonian. And this Hamiltonian is quite simple. So one writes Jij cosine pi minus pi j. And this is ij. And the picture is the following, that one has grain, so granular superconductor, for example. Or one can think of junctions. So now one can see in any journal pictures of Josephson junctions, and people do it really have reached a fantastic level of precision of making these structures. They are quite uniform. People do try to not only try but make qubits, and these superconducting arrays of Josephson junctions is one of candidates for quantum computing, for quantum information. So one has superconductors in each grain, and this superconductor has a phase. And this I, this is number of this grain. And one has interaction between different grains. Interaction means just this Josephson energy, coupling energy between two superconductors. So in the minimum one has all phases equal. So this minimum can be, if Jij is a positively defined matrix, then this minus cosine reaches minimum if all phases are equal. In principle, nowadays people already know there are possibilities to make so-called pi junctions. This means that the minimum is achieved when phases of adjacent grains start shifted by pi, but these pi junctions and all those interesting things are already possible if one has ferromagnets inside, so between the junctions and so on. So,
question. Yeah? Two questions. How many dimensions, and I and J are arbitrary or just nearest neighbor?
Okay. For theoreticians, everything is possible.
In physical systems.
No, physical systems. Physical systems, first, there can be granular superconductors. So then people produce arrays of grains, and these grains can be size even down to 10 angstrom, so 10 and so 5 until 500 angstrom. Of course, it can be, they can be even larger, and this can be a three-dimensional or very thin and so on. But more somehow advanced technology allows to do also two-dimensional arrays of junctions. So one can see just some islands, and for example here in Saclay there was a group of Divare, and now there's Steph, so all this done just in the neighboring half of the building. And these are two-dimensional. And they can be really seen using microscopes and so on. So everything is possible. Then the range of this Jij. Of course, in this picture, it is nearest neighbors. In principle, Long-range interaction, long-range GIJ are also possible when people put the superconducting ions on a metallic substrate. Then via this metal, so electrons penetrate over longer distances, then this GIJ can be more long-range. So, but this is not everything. So if one writes it this way, it is just a classical system, phase is classical. One should recall that also these electrons, these Cooper pairs, when they jump from grain to grain, they are charged. So electrons are charged, so you cannot avoid that. And therefore, there is a Coulomb interaction between electrons. So suppose that if one the pair of electrons jumps from here to here, then this is charged with minus, this is charged with plus, this is with minus, and then it is high energy. So therefore, in order to jump from grain to grain, in order to have supercurrents, the Coulomb interaction will act against the superconductivity. So one should take into account the Coulomb interaction. And I write here it as IJ, and I write here B. Let me put BIJ, and here I write rho I, rho J. This is Coulomb interaction, and BIJ, this matrix B, is inversely proportional to matrix C, and this is capacitance matrix. Just Coulomb interaction from any textbook on classical, even not electrodynamics, electrostatics. But still, it is not quantum. How one gets a quantum Hamiltonian? One should write, in order to get quantum Hamiltonian, one should write here operator. And tell that commutator is equal to minus I. Conventional Latin I, which means the square root of minus I. So this is the conventional commutation relation between number of particles and phase. And if I introduce this, then rho can be also written as minus d, d phi. This is conjugate. So now it is a quantum Hamiltonian. So we see the number of particles in this number of Cooper pairs in each grain and phase, and they do not commute. Therefore, therefore it is very important that this fluctuation should be taken into account. Now, okay, I do it qualitatively, but of course all these things can be derived and has been derived microscopically. And then the point is that these fluctuations we understand intuitively when quantum mechanics becomes important. It becomes important at low temperatures. So, and I tell you the result, qualitative result. At high temperatures, one can just forget about this classical Coulomb interaction, just Coulomb interaction, and concentrate on this phi I minus phi j. Then, at low temperatures, it is an order phase, but then fluctuations start to be important at high temperatures. And the temperature is the only thing that disorders, tries to disorder these phases. And if they are well disordered, there is a transition temperature above which so the order parameter is not. So, superconductivity means the following. Superconductivity means that an average of cosine phi is some finite quantity. So let me denote it by delta. So this is not delta, this is not just all the parameter for the superconductor within the grain. This is some delta, which is the average of cosine phi, and this average should be done with this Hamiltonian H. So if this average exists, then it is superconducting. If it does not, then it is some disordered state. And classical behavior means the following, that critical temperature exists, Tc, and T larger than this Tc, it is disordered phase or normal phase. And for T smaller than Tc, it is superconductivity. So in principle, I speak in terms of Josephson junctions with superconductivity, but I could as well speak in terms of ferromagnetic grains. And this would be, this term would be just Heisenberg, so just interaction between magnetic moments of the grains. And in principle, one could write similar Hamiltonian, but with a different symmetry of the other parameter, but in principle is the same. And in this picture, so in the classical region, everything is somehow classical, but what is interesting, the quantum criticality comes into play when we are at low temperatures. So then what happens? Quantum phase transition. And quantum phase transition means the following. So this means the following, that T, let us take T equals zero, and then for J larger than some critical J, I don't specify what is J now, so the nearest neighbor, for example. Then we have superconductivity. And if J is smaller than JC, it is a disordered phase. So why it happens? One can understand it very well without making calculations. And this JC is of the order of this B. And I'm sorry that possibly I had to write here if rho is just density of particles and not the charge, I had to write here also E squared to be precise. So therefore, one can write that this is E squared, and this is of the order of E squared divided by the capacitance. So what happens? Due to this commutation relation, if J is weak between the grains, you have this superconducting Cooper pairs, but the phase must fluctuate. So if you have completely isolated grains, then due to this relation, rho is fixed, phase strongly fluctuates. And therefore, you add a little bit Josephson coupling, but still fluctuations are so strong, and then that cosine, again write that cosine phi average means superconductivity. And then, due to this uncertainty principle, your phase fluctuates so strong that a comparatively low Josephson coupling cannot stabilize the phases all over the system. It can be stabilized only when this Josephson coupling exceeds some critical value. And this critical value, there are no other energies in the system. This critical value is just to better write what I mean, I write here factor of 2. This is the Coulomb energy of one Cooper pair, which arises when you move a Cooper pair from one grain to the other. We have two grains, neutral grains, and then we move the Cooper pair from here to here. This acquires this charge plus, this acquires the charge minus, and then it is already some amount of classical Coulomb interaction, and here one gets this energy, and this energy can be overcome for motion of pairs when the Josephson energy becomes larger than this one. So this is physical meaning of this quantum phase transition, which means that on the phase diagram, if you write here temperature and here J, you expect superconductivity only after some critical J. This is the critical temperature. And here you have, if you are at zero temperature, then if your J is small enough, but then still, then this means that for small J, you don't have any ordered phase, and only after that you get superconductivity. Again, I should emphasize that this picture is applicable not only to superconductivity. You may have somehow ferromagnetic grains, and to speak now of macroscopic superconductivity or macroscopic ferromagnetism, which means that you have, if you keep in mind that these grains are maybe ferromagnetic but not superconducting, this means that for some coupling for ferromagnetic grains, this is some kind of Heisenberg coupling, interaction between magnetic moments. Only if this interaction exceeds some critical value, one gets a macroscopic superconductivity or ferromagnetism. And this is how the quantum phase transition occurs. So if we speak of cuprates or those very complicated systems that are under intensive study for last couple decades, then one tunes this coupling, adding some holes in the system, which means that just doping plays the role of this J. And if you start with antiferromagnet like in cuprates, adding holes, you actually quite fast you achieve some critical value when the antiferromagnetic transition is destroyed. And then all this variety of interesting phenomena occurs. But first you destroy the antiferromagnet. So what happens in cuprates is a different story, as I will try to show a little bit later, because first one can think about in terms of quantum phase transition, and one would expect naively that it is just like here, that you first destroy antiferromagnetism, and then this is quantum phase transition. Then there are fluctuations, and fluctuations can be very strong near this phase transition, and I will now turn to fluctuations near the quantum critical point. And I will show that, in principle, quantum critical behavior near such quantum critical point is much, to a great extent, like classical critical behavior, but with dimension d plus 1. So this means that if we have classical two-dimensional system, then classically two-dimensional, then in quantum behavior, quantum critical behavior will be like classical critical behavior, but in dimension 3. So that one adds an additional dimension due to quantum fluctuations. That is somehow the common knowledge, and more or less, so for all those interesting systems like cuprates, more or less people were speaking about these systems in the same terms. That one writes some renormalization group equations, one calculates critical indices and so on, and this research may be starting work writing all these renormalization group equations and so on was due to John Hertz, which was 1979, I believe. And since then, when people were talking about quantum criticality, it was usual somehow studying of scaling relations, calculating exponents, and so on. And it turns out now that in two-dimensional case, for the case of these cuprates, the behavior can be completely different, but this different behavior, in order to say that this is a different non-conventional behavior, something new, I have to show you what is the conventional behavior. Otherwise, so there is nothing to talk about. So, I have argued that there is a critical behavior, quantum critical point, and then I want already to move to the critical behavior, how one studies the critical behavior, which means now, first, what is the dependence of physical quantities on the parameter J minus JC? This is first thing. So now we have not only temperature, we have also critical J. We have two parameters. What happens if we take the temperature equals zero and then go to tune J? Or what happens if you have already considerable temperature? What happens here? So this is actually some crossover, and this crossover resembles this dimensional crossover that I have demonstrated to you in the beginning of this lecture. But now I want to sketch again how people, what are the arguments, how one derives the critical behavior near this transition point. So this was about existence of such critical point, and now I will move to study of critical behavior. In principle, one can demonstrate how this transition appears using some mean field approximation. In the mean field approximation, one gets this critical J quite easily, and this is the procedure. The main steps are the same as when one speaks of classical criticality. In classical criticality, the zero step is to make mean field, to derive Landau expansion and study first within Landau equations. Next step, is to take into account fluctuations, to write renormalization group equations, and calculate exponents for power law behavior. More or less, for this conventional system, one can proceed in quantum region just in the same way. So this means first, mean field theory for this for zero temperature or finite temperature, finding this this curve, and second, calculating fluctuations, and then with these fluctuations, again they will be divergent near the critical point, and then near this critical point, one will have divergent expressions, which will be summed up into some exponents. And I must say that in this classical picture, if you have this transition between, for example, antiferromagnet magnet and normal metal, and if you are in three dimensions, for example, in this classical picture, there is no space for getting superconductivity or charge modulation and all those things. So they appear in two dimensions. And they appear already not within this conventional picture of quantum criticality. Okay, but now what is the conventional picture and how one should proceed starting from this Hamiltonian? That's the first thing, what one can do with this Hamiltonian. So I, as much as possible, you'll try to avoid complicated calculations. In most cases, just sketching how one can do. So, we have this Hamiltonian. And now, let me use not conventional representation with Hamiltonians, but let me use Feynman ideas and Richard Feynman, who has demonstrated that one can reformulate the quantum mechanics in terms of an integral over paths. So this means the following, that you may forget about quantum operators and so on, and you may formulate everything in terms of classical Lagrangians, but then you have, but in classical mechanics you have only one trajectory, and this is classical mechanics. In quantum mechanics, due to Feynman, can be reformulated in terms of the sum over all paths with some certain weight. So due to Feynman, one uses action, Lagrangian. For example, Lagrangian. And action. And action. Action S, which is integral L d tau. In principle, of course, quantum mechanics is reformulated in terms of conventional Lagrangian and time, real time. When one wants to study thermodynamics, it is possible to reformulate it in terms of imaginary time. So tau is imaginary time. And this is the integral from zero to beta. And beta is 1 over temperature. And then one calculates the partition function in the beginning it was, so for quantum mechanics it was trace over all h divided by t, This is quantum mechanics, conventional quantum mechanics. And due to Feynman, one writes the integral over minus, and here I write 0 to beta, and here I write classical Lagrangian, and this is the integral over all configurations of phi, over all phi of tau. This is Feynman path integral. So, and what remains to be done is to write the corresponding Lagrangian corresponding to this quantum Hamiltonian. And we know how to write a Lagrangian if one knows the Hamiltonian or vice versa. So, if we have the Hamiltonian, then in order to write the Lagrangian, one should simply replace this dd phi by phi dot by velocities. To replace momentum by velocities. Or if one goes from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics, one replaces velocities by momentum operators. This is what is well known, and therefore to write the Lagrangian from this Hamiltonian is a simple task. And this simple task means that I write the Lagrangian in the form as minus j I j cosine phi I minus phi j. And sum 1 half I j. And now I have to write the Coulomb interaction. And for the Coulomb interaction, I have to replace rho by the velocity. In principle, I have the Coulomb interaction. It is not diagonal in rho because you may have interaction between grains. And this is achieved simply by writing 1 over 2, and here I write I j, and I write here C I j phi I dot phi j dot. And E squared, I believe, would be good here. So I had, when I wrote interaction rho I, rho j, I wrote here the matrix which was I j. Inverse matrix of inverse capacitance matrix. Now, when writing the Lagrangian, one writes on this conventional, as just matrix capacitance matrix. And this is the Lagrangian. So, in Feynman reformulation, one has the integral over the phases and functional integral over all configurations of phases, and one has the Lagrangian, which has again the interaction between phi plus this Coulomb interaction written in this form. Why do I do that? It is not just an exercise. Simply, if one wants already to study the critical behavior, one can actually understand very well what has happened. We have now an additional dimension. And this additional dimension is the imaginary term. So we have reformulated quantum mechanics in terms of the path integral, but we got immediately from here an additional dimension, and this additional dimension is imaginary time, and therefore one already can understand very well my statement that if we consider quantum effects, we may have just additional dimension. talking about quantum criticality, criticality in two dimensions would mean that it is just three-dimensional system, for example, effectively three-dimensional system.